Well, you know, the thing is, if you ask any filmmaker at this point of the film where you've got 3 or 4 days left for release, and he says that I'm very excited and I'm looking forward, he's lying. You just feel so anxious that 2 years or 3 years of work is going to be judged in such few days. I'm anxious to know what people feel and how they react to the film, of what we believed and we loved, and how they react to it. I have those butterflies in the stomach, and it doesn't get easier with every film. It gets worse with every film. It's not like your first film, you think you are the most pressurized, but the fact is you have no idea how much the pressure keeps growing, because now people know you and they expect some things from you, and it just all adds up together now. Well, each time I try to do something, I don't do anything consciously like that. What I try to do is I try to take up material that I can indulge myself into. I'm the kind of director who likes to live the film in whatever way I can do, and something of me bleeds into the film each time. Hamari didn't hit the box office numbers, didn't do it, and even the appreciation that I wanted, but I wanted to make a mature love story at that time, because at the age of 35 they would allow me to do it, and not at the age of 50, I think. So I think it was just something I wanted to deal with, but that's what it is. In this process, you can't just have all hits all the time. You fall, you stumble, you get up again, and you sometimes run and sometimes you have it. And so, you know, the thing to believe that every film you do will be super successful at the box office is not actually entirely true. You learn more from your failures than you learned from your successes, at least. Why I've grown with my films, I think, is because I really did grow up with my films. I mean, my first film released when I was 22 or 23 years old, or 24 years old, and I'm 36 now. So it's been 12 years since I've been making films. I mean, 11 films in 12 years. So I have been at it. So yes, I obviously have learned from my previous one, but I have no regret about anything that I've done in the past or the things I have not done, or the actors I've worked with who I've not worked with. I like this whole process of making a film, and I want to keep doing that for the rest of my life. You know, I felt a lot of pressure after my first film had come out and the second film was coming out to get songs like Bola Meo Baate had come and gone insane. Ever since then, I realized that I was not competing with anyone else in the industry, but I was competing with myself. And at that time, you know, no big music directors were working with me, because I was just this new director and 22 years of age and making a film. So I worked with these new guys and who, you know, worked together, 3-4 of them, and made one album out of it. So that style became actually a way of living, I think, because even Aashiqui had 3 composers. And even when I was making Aashiqui, the whole pressure of living up to Aashiqui 1 couldn't be bigger than that. But the truth is, I don't try to just give you a super hit song. I've never done that. I've put that requirement with my music directors. I actually, all my songs are situational. My characters don't sing songs when they're not singers. It's not a lip sync song. I use music to interpret my material. So like, for example, a song in this film called Main Phir Bhi Tumko Chahunga is actually the emotional crux of this film, which talks what Madhav Jha's character would feel even if tomorrow Riya Somani didn't end up with him. He would still love her. So I use them as screenplay tools rather than just things to attract people. So the day I don't have a story to tell, my music will be bad, I think. So the pressure actually is more on my music directors now, I think, because they all feel that if they can't be the one giving me a bad song. I keep saying, the music directors, the singers, the composers, and the lyricists that I have worked with. I've never worked with big stars, but what would I be without an Atif Aslam, Arijit Singh, Ankit Tiwari, Rahat Saab, Toshi Sharan, all of them. I mean, they're the ones who actually got me here. I actually do make situation songs. I don't actually make them for a super hit song. I've never fit a song into a film because it's a hit song, you know. And I don't like lyrics which are difficult words, but I like big thoughts being said in simple words. So I think it's not how you say it, or what language you say it. It's important what you say, and that's why lyrics become important in my films. But I think if you communicate the emotion right, it definitely adds up to your film. I mean, what would Aashiqui's definition be if it wasn't Tum Hi Ho? Similarly, Phir Bhi Tumko Chahunga. It's the emotional crux at the belief that Madhav Jha and the girl have throughout the film of how they feel about each other. In fact, it's a new role for Shraddha. The thing with Shraddha is whenever I work with her, she turns on and throws the ball into my court by not reading the script and sort of says that I love you, just I know you've come with something great to me. That actually brings up the whole responsibility on the film a lot to me. I can't, I have a relationship with her which I have developed since Aashiqui, which I cannot misuse. By putting the whole thing about that you love me and you will get it sorted, means I have to give it that kind of importance and I can't let her down. But the reason I also feel that I can't keep using the same mode with her, because she's an actor, she needs to grow. So she can't just be the girl next door in every film. So in this film, she plays Riya Somani, who's a high class, highbrow, Delhi Lutheran spoiled girl, who actually, thinks in English and travels the world. And that's something that was very different from what she played in, whether Arohi or whether she played in Villain Aisha. But what I like about Shraddha is because she's India's sweetheart and the kind of roles that she's done, somewhere she has, even if you play a role like this, it looks like there's some heart behind it. There is some feeling also there. So I just didn't want one person who can get very isolated and you don't fall in love with. I would not take credit for the star that she is, but I can take credit for discovering that star. I've always worked in the casting with the heart, with my heart, and not with things that I feel is market potential. Whether it was working with Imran Hashmi, whether it was, taking Siddharth Malhotra in a film like Villain, when he was known as a chocolatey guy, to take him for an angster in character, whether taking Ritesh Deshmukh as a comedian into Villain to play a serial killer. I've always casted people by an emotional impulse because of what I've seen in them. So I think Shraddha falls into the same category as that. Like, I saw something in her that I thought she could play Arohi, and not because of what her potential was and what she actually was trying to do. No, the thing is, he had not released the book, and he met me once and he gave me the manuscript of the book, which actually had way before the release of the book. This was in July, August or something, and October is when this book released. And he gave me the book and he told me to read it. And I first was apprehensive because it was called Half Girlfriend, and I'm known for like films like Villain and Aashiqui, which are emotionally driven and stuff like that. And I thought this was going to be some fluff college film or something like that. But as I went through the pages, I really enjoyed what it had. It had an emotional arc. It was an Indian love story, and it's very difficult to find new avenues in a love story, because essentially every love story boils down to boy met girl, boy loses girl, boy gets girl back. But it's the journey which is actually new every time. And I think a lot of us get inspired by the modern concepts of like Live-In and Friends with Benefits. And so what I saw here in the book was there was an Indian love story, and he had done things like he'd taken a Bihari character to play a love story. Normally Biharis are just stereotypical in our Hindi films as gangsters or politicians. Yeah, he was not romancing in Lucknow and Jaipur and all the stuff that you've seen before, but he was romancing in Patna, and that's where real love is. It's not done in exotic locations. I mean, whenever I fall in love, suddenly the locations have not become exotic. When I fall in love, it is in the city. It is living, breathing. It's alive in your normalcy of life, and that's what this book had. And so I was drawn to that. And this, so what I think is, it's unlike normally people set up projects. It was not like me, Chetan and Ekta came together and then we wrote a film because we decided to make a project. It was a book which the initial source material was a script, and then based on that I got associated with Chetan, and then Ekta came on board. So it was actually a film that got made rather than a project set up. That's what actually drew me to it. You've got to live with the script for the next 12 months or a year more than that of your life. You better enjoy it. It's like a relationship you're going to be in. If it's not something you enjoy, there are going to be bad days, there are going to be difficult days on the shoot. But in the end, it's a film that you love and you're going to be there. So I just keep... you could go wrong, but in the end, and choose the wrong script. But in the end, you should be something that you loved. Main fir bhi tumko chahunga, for sure. Not for anything else, it just binds. In few movies I've got that one song that actually talks about.
Like
Yeah, it's written in. It was written as a nazm actually, which Manoj Mutashir had written 12 years back actually. He had just written and read it out to me as a poem to me, and I said, keep this, I want this for half girlfriend. I was making Hamari at that time. And he said, not for Hamari. I said, no, that's for, this is for that film. We obviously restructured it and made it into a lyrical format, but it, the source material is a poetry that he written in Kashmir. So I think it's one song that actually talks about the whole emotional journey of these two characters, and it, that's why I'm a little biased towards it. You know, I understand that box office success is really important, and you need to make money for people so that they invest and let you make more movies. But the way I like to make my movies is I put in a lot of heart into it, and so does everyone around my team. I mean, no one was playing boss on this team. Everyone was working their heart out. It was their film. It wasn't a film we were all working together saying we need to report on time. Everyone felt the need to, till last night when, you know, assistants who were not even supposed to be in the post were sitting and working with me. So we've all put our hearts out there, and I hope this film stays in people's hearts more than anything else. Like, for example, you know, people still meet me and talk about Aashiqui. It's been 4 years, but it's not a film that's crossed 100 crores or something like that. I would like the fact that, you know, if people even 10 years down the line meet me for Half Girlfriend and say they believed in this film and they really liked it. That's not purchasable. For all you guys watching, please go watch Half Girlfriend 19th of May in a cinema next to you. Don't go with half the number of people, go with the full amount that you have.